Did you know that you could create hydrogen with a battery in a glass of water? When I drop this 9-volt battery inside this glass of water, it splits the hydrogen and oxygen atoms to create a stream of pure hydrogen. This process is called electrolysis.
And it could also be produced like this at a much larger scale. And it's called green hydrogen because the process of making the hydrogen doesn't rely on fossil fuels as raw materials, nor does it entail any carbon emissions. Green hydrogen has been positioned as a fuel of the future, promising to provide a low carbon energy source for transportation and utilities. But of the many methods used to produce hydrogen, many entail carbon emissions somewhere in the process. And actually, only 0.02% of global hydrogen production can be considered green. So it makes me wonder, can green hydrogen phase out fossil fuels? Are there any risks? Will we ever use it in our cars and homes? Let's find out. On this episode of Can It Save the Planet, I'm visiting the Plug Gigafactory in upstate New York to talk to plant manager Dan O'Connell to learn more about how green hydrogen is produced, its benefits, its limitations, and ultimately find out if green hydrogen can save the planet.
Presented by Astral Tequila.
Hydrogen is the most abundant element in this universe. It powers the sun, it makes up water, and in modern civilization, it can help fuel our transportation among many other things. And when you burn hydrogen as an end-use fuel, it doesn't produce carbon dioxide. But the most common way of producing pure hydrogen is by splitting water and methane molecules using a process called steam-methane reforming. The steam-methane reforming process not only uses methane, which is a fossil fuel, but it also requires a lot of heat to make the chemical reaction happen in the first place. And the heat often comes from non-renewable energy sources. And if that wasn't enough, part of the reaction process itself also releases carbon dioxide. Globally, hydrogen is responsible for about 843 metric tons of CO2 emissions annually. That's as much as the UK and Indonesia's emissions combined. Then there's the process of electrolysis. Similar to my little science experiment in the intro, which, when powered by renewable energy, is one way to produce clean hydrogen. The only byproduct is water vapor. Now, green hydrogen is one of three broad categories of carbon production. Actually, green is the cleanest, but there's gray hydrogen, which is produced from natural gas and other fossil fuel sources. Then there's blue hydrogen, which is also produced from fossil fuels, but captures and stores some of the CO2 created in the process. Currently, most hydrogen being produced is gray, and it's mostly used for industrial processes like treating metal and refining petroleum, as rocket fuel in space exploration, and to power up fuel cell vehicles as an alternative to EVs and the internal combustion engine. That's why there are companies around the world working on ways to make green hydrogen more prominent and efficient. One of them is Plug Power, which opened up a gigafactory in upstate New York in 2021 to not only produce green hydrogen, but also develop fuel cell systems to power vehicles with clean energy.
I'm talking to Dan O'Connell, the plant manager here in Rochester, New York, to get a tour of Plug's gigafactory and learn more about the process of making green hydrogen and its applications.
Green hydrogen can be used in lots of different things. It's great for our primary application, a fuel cell forklift. We have about 60,000 forklifts out there in the field today that refuel 3 times a day, run 24/7. The next steps are to talk about other mobility applications. Automotive, you can use a fuel cell to create electricity for backup power.
Fuel cells are these devices that generate electricity through an electrochemical reaction, not combustion. So like combining hydrogen and oxygen to generate electricity, heat, and water.
Right now I'm kind of in a nascent stage. Are there any issues when it comes to scaling it up?
There are three big things, and that is bringing along the supplier network. As we expand the electrolyzer business here in this factory, we also have to get our suppliers because we use a number of different raw materials, catalysts, membrane, as well as some metals that we use.
As with most new solutions, another obstacle for scaling green hydrogen is cost, especially when it comes to the precious metal content needed to create fuel cells and electrolyzers.
To think back about automotive industry 30 years ago when catalytic converters first came, they used an awful lot of precious metal in those catalytic converters. Over the last 30 years, they've really optimized the use, so they've really reduced the amount of precious metal in a catalytic converter, as well as improved the efficiency. And we're on that same path for fuel cells and electrolyzers.
Do you see this kind of solution phasing out fossil fuels in the future?
We're slowly moving in that direction. And I think we need to make hydrogen ubiquitous in our society. You need to put it in your natural gas lines, vehicles, backup power. I've been working on it for about 20 years now, and I can't wait until hydrogen is the fuel of the future today.
Although Dan is a firm believer that green hydrogen is the future, rolling it out at scale could become an obstacle.
We have several hundred warehouses around the United States that now have hydrogen for refueling tractor trailers. I think cars are the longest leg in that scenario because it's going to take a while to get 50,000 hydrogen stations to be able to go coast to coast.
Other than infrastructure and cost, another potential hurdle for this technology is public perception. Many people associate hydrogen with being explosive.
I drove a hydrogen fuel cell car for about 5 years. It had a very large hydrogen tank under the back seat of that vehicle, and I put my two kids in the back seat and drove all over town. We did ballistic tests on the tanks. We crash tested the vehicles. Very little hydrogen is available outside the tank. I think they're actually safer than gasoline.
However, Dan says the group that takes the most convincing to back up green hydrogen are those creating our energy policies.
If we could get a consistent energy policy that was independent of politics, and we were stayed focused on making hydrogen the fuel that it should be, and pushing the legislation to go faster, I think it would really help us go much quicker. The technology is available today. We just got to scale it up, which is what you see at the factory here that we're doing.
Well, now it's time to see the technology up close and test it. As Dan mentioned, one of the applications of green hydrogen is powering forklifts in big warehouses. So we're going to learn how to refuel a forklift, since it's the closest thing we have to a car that runs on green hydrogen.
Very similar to what you do with gasoline today. You pull up, put the nozzle in, squeeze the trigger, and it does all the rest for you. One of the benefits of a green hydrogen fuel cell forklift is its ability to recharge at the start of a shift, run for 8 hours at full power, go in and out of a cold chamber without any loss of operating capability. And you can refill it in about 3 minutes.
It was less than 3 minutes.
So now we can show you taking it for a spin.
I would love to take it for a spin, yeah. I'll definitely be coming back to take a forklift for a ride. But first, let's look at green hydrogen's pros and cons. Here's what we learned so far. Number one, green hydrogen isn't ubiquitous enough to phase out fossil fuels, but it can help decarbonize certain sectors. Number two, fuel cell vehicles are safer than gas-powered vehicles, but there is some concern over leaks. And number three, green hydrogen development and infrastructure is still too expensive and not built out enough for us to use it as a reliable clean energy source. So, can green hydrogen save the planet? Not yet, but it has a lot of potential. Green hydrogen is currently nearly 2 to 3 times more expensive than blue hydrogen. And when it comes to applications, like in cars, hydrogen storage tanks and fuel cells are also expensive to make since they require precious metals that are in high demand. Speaking of cars, cars powered by hydrogen fuel cells are more expensive than their battery-powered EV counterparts, more than twice as much in some cases, although that will eventually even out. And it costs more to fuel them up than to charge an EV. But hydrogen fuel cell vehicles refuel faster than it takes to recharge an EV. As for infrastructure, it's lacking. Fuel cell cars can't use the same refill stations any other type of car uses. And there aren't that many hydrogen fueling stations to begin with. In the US, there are about 55 public hydrogen fueling stations available. All but one of them are in California. So even if I wanted to drive a hydrogen car here in New York, I wouldn't have anywhere to fuel it. There's also some skepticism around its efficiency. There are people like Elon Musk who's referred to green hydrogen as mind-boggling stupid and called them fool cells on Twitter. But there's also some concern from science and policymakers who highlight the lack of data surrounding hydrogen leaks that come with scaling up the technology and the risks posed to the climate and the environment more broadly. All that being said, it can help decarbonize certain sectors and help with long-term energy storage. There's also a lot of investment, research, and development going into green hydrogen. In 2020, the US promised to invest $100 million in research and development for hydrogen and fuel cell technology. It's a drop in the bucket compared to other investments in renewable energy, but it's a start. The European Union has also said it will invest heavily in renewable hydrogen to meet its 2030 climate goals. Overall, the hydrogen industry, including green hydrogen, is positioned to have nearly $500 billion of investments by 2030. There are projects like the world's largest green hydrogen project being built in Lancaster, California. Then there's the Advanced Clean Energy Storage Facility planned in Utah, a green hydrogen facility capable of providing long-term energy storage. And the Green Hydrogen Catapult Initiative, which aims to cut the cost of green hydrogen to below $2 per kilogram while increasing its production by 50-fold before 2027. For reference, in California, 1 kilogram of hydrogen at one of its hydrogen stations can cost anywhere from $10 to $17, which is equivalent to about $5 to $8.50 per gallon of gasoline. I've laid out some of the pros and cons of adopting green hydrogen, but of course, a paradigm shift in our energy infrastructure is needed. But in terms of appeal and consumer buy-in, ultimately, the success of green hydrogen is depending on cost. In the meantime, I'm gonna take this forklift for a ride.